Hi, my name is Ambrose Freeman-Toole, and welcome to my senior Capstone presentation. One could say the musical journey, which eventually led me to earning my Bachelor of Music concentration in composition from Western Oregon University,
stemmed from a belief my father held, that a composer should have in their oeuvre a symphony, a string quartet, a piano sonata, and other established forms.
Essentially what he was saying was study the masters and do as they did. I have spent my time here at WU in a chronological study of musical styles,
starting with music of the Ars Nova and the Renaissance, and ending in the modern age of film scoring. Along the way, I studied Guillaume Dufay and the Franco-Flemish chanson, Thomas Louis de Victoria and motets of the High Renaissance, the symphonies of Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, Johannes Brahms and chamber works of the 19th century, jazz, and film scores of the 20th century.
For each of these topics, I composed a model composition, utilizing techniques appropriate for the given era or genre. What we will be looking at today are three of these model compositions.
A motet for four voices, based on Victoria and Palestrina's motets of the High Renaissance. A sonata for horn and piano, based on Brahms and the expanded tonality of the 19th century. And a film score which requires an understanding of bossa nova, as well as knowledge of the indigenous tribes of the Amazon and the natural world that inspires them. My evolution as a composer at Western Oregon University began with the study of the Renaissance. To glean the most interesting aspects of Renaissance music, one must have at least a base understanding of the dynamics of the European Renaissance. Very briefly, let's touch upon three main ideas which will aid in the understanding of Renaissance music. Humanism, the faltering of the Roman Catholic Church, and an understanding of modality versus tonality.
Humanism.
A movement inspired by Petrarch and other scholars of the Renaissance, in which culture, quote, turned away from medieval scholasticism and revived interest in ancient Greek and Roman thought. To this end, it was an era, quote, in which human learning and endeavor, freed from the constraints of an overly religious Middle Ages, became more focused on human achievement. The Renaissance, or rebirth, sought to achieve this through ushering in an age of exploration and invention, a return to reason, logic, and empiricism.
Throughout the Renaissance, the Roman Catholic Church was in turmoil,
consistently plagued with corruption and scandal. The Western Schism, or the Papal Schism, of 1378 through 1417,
was a fracture within the church and regional rulers, which resulted in three different bishops claiming title to the papal throne.
In the 16th century, multiple Protestant denominations, including Lutheranism and Calvinism, were formed in protest of the Roman Catholic Church. This was known as the Reformation. In the following years, the Catholic Church formed its own council to address abuses and reforms within the church. This was known as the Counter-Reformation. As disillusionment with the church grew throughout the Renaissance, secularism rose within the European populace. Avoiding an overly technical definition, the type of modal compositions we are working with are compositions which utilize modes, that is, scales made up of different combinations of whole steps and half steps. In our case, these compositions are written in a predominantly horizontal, linear fashion, opposed to vertically stacked tertiary harmony. Much of the repertoire was created by building new melodies and compositions over pre-existing chant or plain song. Tonality, generally described as an arrangement of pitches and/or chords with direction and stability based on the triadic one or tonic chord. Let's end on this quote from Howard M. Brown and Louise K. Stein's Music in the Renaissance on harmonic progressions in the Renaissance. Quote, "Neither Lasso nor his contemporaries had a technical vocabulary capable of explaining in detail the way each chord within a mode relates to its tonic, and we have still not devised a completely satisfactory method of dealing with the tonal implications of modal music." Okay, so how do these events actually impact music of the era? One, we must understand that a major employer of musicians of the Renaissance were the various churches. Composers, who are typically also instrumentalists, choir masters, or clergy, were responsible for writing music for weekly masses, yearly religious celebrations, and secular works for entertaining visiting dignitaries and the like. And two, we must understand that part of this great divide within the church was in part, or in some sense, a battle over progressivism versus conservatism. Part of that conservatism is what kind of heathenistic, barbarous music do we allow during church services, and what stipulations do we put on those compositions? Through the use of intelligent counterpoint and a combination of polyphony and homophony, composers of the late Renaissance, such as Palestrina and Victoria, were able to compose heavenly, fluid music, which still allowed the words of the religious text to be clearly understood, one of the many concerns voiced by heads of church at the Council of Trent, the council formed during the Counter-Reformation. My work entitled Flos, Florum for Four Voices is a model composition imitating the motets of Thomas Luis de Victoria and other composers of the High Renaissance. I chose the motet, described as a polyphonic choral composition based on either a sacred or secular text, simply because I wanted to compose for a chamber choir rather than a 200-piece concert choir. If I had, I may have composed a mass or a requiem. Before you begin composing, find a text which inspires you. This could be part of the Mass Ordinary, a psalm, a multitude of Catholic writings by clerics such as Hildegard of Bingen, or really any text at all you want to work with. The chosen text, either secular or sacred, will provide guidance in terms of tone, phrase structure, and overall form. In my case, Flos Florum was a text I discovered while researching Guillaume Dufay. This text is in 5 stanzas. The form is A, B, 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 and that is how I approached it. My aim was for each stanza to have its own character while utilizing themes and ideas from previous stanzas. In my experience, the hardest thing about composing is the first measure. So I studied the motets of Victoria and looked for patterns. What I found was this scenario here, where one voice enters, a second voice enters a fifth below, then the rest of the voices either follow suit in imitative counterpoint or begin to flesh out the harmony. Once the voices have entered, what do you do with them? The answer is typically imitation, something we will be seeing a lot of today. You can see imitation here, here, and here. Text painting, which really just means having the music descriptively mirroring what is happening in the text, can be used to highlight or accentuate portions of the text. It can also provide guidance as to where to take the melody or phrase. In Flos Florum, you can see here in the portion of the text regarding Regina, the melody ascends in pitch, symbolizing majesty and wonder. This one sentiment allows for logical direction of the melodic line, which in turn will trigger imitation throughout the other voices, as well as creating the harmonic outline to be filled in by the other voices. So why would one waste hours and hours of their life composing seemingly archaic neo-Renaissance music? One, because it frustrated me not being able to write music which sounded like it was composed in the 16th century. In this medium, it is easy for one's compositions to come off sounding like voice-leading exercises, a chorale, which sound more Baroque or classical in nature. For example, it really took me 3 tries to perfect this compositional style. My first attempt was a model composition in the style of Dufay. My second was a work for soprano and viol quartet, inspired by William Byrd and English composers of the 16th century. And lastly, the piece we will be hearing today, Flos Florum for 4 voices, composed in fall of 2022. Though these pieces are quite different and span a difference of over 200 years, they all share one thing in common, which is that they are all written in a linear style using modal counterpoint and not the established tonal musical idioms which are solidified in the Baroque. And 2, this is actually a very marketable skill for a composer looking to score for film, series, or video games. Pop culture always has an appetite for period pieces. Whether it be traditional instrumentation or simply modal, esoteric-influenced sound design, early music influences can be found in any number of films and video games. Fast forward about 300 years, and let's talk about Brahms and 19th century Romanticism.
This was a very important era for me to study, because falling in love with the sweeping, epic works of
Brahms,
Mahler,
Gambleputty,
Wagner,
Dubon, Hausfern, Splendenschlitz,
Sansah,
Kreskrenbon, Friedegedangle, Dungelbar, Steinborn, Neckthresher, Appelbanger,
Berlioz,
Grandisch, Grunwald, Neuerspelter, Wasser, Köstlich, Imbel, Eisenbahnwagen, Guten Abend, Bitte, Einen Nürnberger, Bratwürstel,
Schumann,
Gespürt mit Zweimarker, Lube, Hunsfurt, Gumberaber, Schonendanke, Kalbsfleisch, Mittelreicher, von Hartkopf of Ulm.
Was one of the factors which eventually led me to abandoning the rock scene to pursue music at the collegiate level.
Water. Like a
The Romantic movement, which rippled through arts and culture in the 19th century, idealized nature, raw human emotion, and again, drawing inspiration from the past, this time, medieval aesthetics. This is in part a revolt against the rise of industrialism and the separation of man from nature. The Romantic era musical aesthetics expanded from the classical era to include larger forms, larger orchestras, more detailed orchestration, and expanded tonality. This era saw the symphonic tone poems of Franz Liszt, the delicate lilting solo piano works of Frédéric Chopin, the pastoral symphonies of Jean Sibelius and Antonin Dvorak, the Germanic folklore-based operas of Richard Wagner, and the old-fashioned art music of Johann Brahms. Art music essentially means non-programmatic music. On a personal note, Brahms is one of my favorite composers, and I hold a special affection for his chamber works, particularly Opus 120, Clarinet Sonatas number 1 and 2. I chose to compose a sonata for horn and piano. I chose this medium because there are a great number of horn works that I admire, and the horn is a well-suited, dynamic solo instrument with a wide and colorful range. Not to mention, I played horn and trombone, and am well aware of the idiosyncrasies of brass instruments. I wanted to create an intimate dialogue between the two instruments, using counterpoint and thematic development. This medium also allowed me to practice my piano accompaniment writing, something that I have always struggled with. This work is primarily an exercise in thematic development, i.e., how many ways can I manipulate, through the use of augmentation, diminution, inversion, and other contrapuntal devices, this opening theme, stated first in the horn, the motif returns here, here, thank you. Finally, as part of my undergraduate studies, I was required to take an ethnomusicology course. In my case, it was an independent study on a topic of my choosing. When determining which culture I would like to study, I was torn between studying Japan or music of the Amazon basin. Ultimately, I decided to study music of the Amazon, in part so I could continue my studies of Latin jazz, one of my favorite genres.
My main area of interest was bossa nova, and I spent countless hours listening to the likes of
João Gilberto, Antonio Carlos Jobim, Nara Liao, Stan Getz, and more. I found the roots of bossa nova terribly interesting. I always enjoyed the chamber music quality of bossa nova, and discovered that that sound was a direct result of a small group of people in Rio de Janeiro that practiced and held soirees almost exclusively in apartment buildings. Part of the bossa nova movement was a transition away from the loud and raucous samba dance bands of the early 20th century into small chamber-sized ensembles with a laid-back groove, more akin to West Coast jazz of the 1950s and 60s. From 1945 to 1964, Brazil had a burgeoning democracy, coupled with economic growth. These years of ease may have allowed for such art forms as bossa nova to flourish. These good times would not last. A military dictatorship would reign in Brazil for the next 20 years. Se aperta o botão, meu coração vai me dizer que é samba sim. Máquina de ritmo, processo de algoritmos padrões. Latin music relies heavily on rhythmic ostinatos. A lot of samba, salsa, and bossa nova pieces are centered around these rhythmic cells, some of which are typically designated to a certain instrument. For instance, the clave is both an instrument and is typically associated with a two-measure rhythmic cell, the son clave. Another example is the cascara. While I was listening to these shakers, clackers, and whistles, I asked myself,
these rhythmic elements sound just like the sounds one would find in nature. Birds, insects, frogs, water.
Is this merely a coincidence? Or are these sounds imitating specific animal sounds of South America? Unsurprisingly, I found that, yes, these are emulations of regional fauna. The peoples of the Amazon have undoubtedly been creating instruments which mimic their surroundings for millenniums, many of which can still be found in indigenous and popular music today. I studied a few different aspects of indigenous Amazon music: melodic material, instrumentation, song texts, and shamanism. The music we will be hearing is primarily pentatonic or modal. Remember, we discussed modes in our conversation about Renaissance music. As important as the actual notes are, I can't imagine them being anywhere as important as the situational circumstances or the timbral affectations associated with a given performance.
What do I mean by that?
Simply put,
we cannot separate the musical characteristics from the importance of shamanistic practices in the Amazon.
As Ramon and Rivera state in their article,
Indigenous Music of Venezuela, regarding Indigenous Music of Venezuela,
quote, music continues to be linked to myths,
which in turn set up the oral history of the origins, and to a ritual which repeats annually parts of the original myth. Hence, it is not pure music, but a cultural complex, which includes text, sound, dance, and drama based on oral tradition. In addition to shamanistic songs, I found texts about nuptials,
mourning, hunting, war, harvest, coming-of-age songs,
and songs which act as allegory or of warning. The peoples of the Amazon use a wide array of instruments. Idiophones, membranophones, aerophones,
and quartophones. As you may imagine, these instruments are made from wood, stone, bone, turtle shell, and other organic matter. While I was listening to old field recordings of this music, I could hear bird calls and insects bleed into the recording, and I was reminded of an anecdote.
Charles Mingus.
Band leader, bassist, and composer
was warming up on stage at a little jazz club.
The bartender shut off the electric fan to cut down on the noise.
Charles Mingus, known to be somewhat of a hothead, jumped over the counter, threw the bartender up against the wall, and said, "Hey, I was using that." We often, purposefully or not, incorporate our surroundings into our performances or ceremonies.
If not physically or aurally, then at the very least emotionally. This would certainly be true in a forest teeming with life.
My initial building block was the use of the bossa nova rhythm I spoke about.
I took this bossa nova rhythm here and placed it in these low drums here and in the clave.
I once read that the clave starts the piece like a starter's pistol and does not let up until the piece concludes. I ran with this idea.
And through the use of augmentation, I built the structure and form of this piece around this persistent rhythm.
One of my takeaways is that I will never truly be able to understand the peoples of the Amazon, or even the peoples of Brazil. People dedicate their entire lives to such endeavors.
But what I can connect with them on is a love for and a wholehearted respect of nature, generally universal within indigenous cultures. This appreciation for nature is what I used as my jumping-off point for my compositional approach. I am an avid field recordist, and I utilized a bird call I recorded on the bluffs outside Denver, Colorado. I have not been able to track down what type of bird it is, possibly something in the finch family, but it sounds like this. Let's take a listen to the opening of the piece, listening for the bossa nova rhythm in the clave and the bird call.
Who should decide the future of the Amazon? The future of our people?
The last piece of the puzzle was simply implementing all of my prior film scoring knowledge to aid with timings, pacing, orchestration, sound design, and mixing. It just so happened that I had this film in my collection, Who Should Decide, provided by the Music Cosmos Film Scoring Competition 2021. Previously, I chose not to score this film because I did not think I could do it justice without doing the proper research. My ethnomusicology class provided an opportunity for me to do this research.
And I thought Who Should Decide would be a good project to implement what I had learned.
Who should decide the future of the Amazon? The future of our people? languages of the jaguars and the anaconda, of the spirits living within our lands. Should the loggers get to decide the fate of our forests? Should the oil executives decide the future of our rivers? We've been protecting our sacred lands for thousands of years, so that our children and your children may live on a healthy planet. Today, we are fighting for our right to protect a forest that gives us all life. Our battle is about who should decide the future of our forest homelands. Those who destroy it, or those who protect it? Join us.
Thanks for taking the time to hang out and join me along this musical journey that I experienced at Western Oregon University. You can see I took my father's advice and worked on a vast array of projects and genres, and I believe I am a better man and composer for it. If you are interested in this style of composition, or this process of composition, my main point of advice would be this. Don't be in a rush. For each of these topics we discussed, I spent anywhere from 3 to 12 months researching and score studying. Thank you again, and take care.